Kovatch, the Associate Program Director for the Blue Ridge Music Center. I'd like to welcome you to the discussion series of Place in the Band, Women in Bluegrass and American Roots Music. This series is part of a project by the Blue Ridge Music Center that began in 2020 to honor the 100th anniversary of women being granted the right to vote. A Place in the Band celebrates the triumphs and explores the struggles faced by women in bluegrass and American roots music. In this discussion series, North Carolina singer, songwriter, and social activist Laurelyn Dossett speaks with women in the music business, including musicians and others involved in music management and promotion roles. Through these conversations, the women share their stories, talking about their role models, mentors, and inspirations, experiences with people they've worked with, issues they've encountered that are specific to women in the industry, changes they've seen over the years, and other parts of their own personal journeys that have helped them to be who they are today. These individual stories show us the collective strength and future possibilities for women in bluegrass and American roots music. I hope you enjoy the series and thank you for joining us.
No conversation about women in bluegrass music would be complete without our next guest, Laurie Lewis. Laurie is a singer, a songwriter, a fiddler, a multi-instrumentalist, really. She's a producer, she's an educator, she's a band leader. Laurie does it all. She's also won multiple Grammys and has several times been named IBMA's Female Vocalist of the Year. She's gonna share some stories with us about her early days in her career and also about some new projects and young musicians who are coming along and inspiring her now. My name's Laurelyn Dossett, and here's Laurie Lewis.
So today we're here with Laurie Lewis. I'm so excited to see you. She's from Berkeley, California today on this late September morning. I'm in Stokes County, North Carolina, and we're here today to talk about women in bluegrass and American roots music. So Laurie, thanks for being here. And I've got a few questions, but I'm also happy for you to just say whatever is on your mind. So there's no big prescription here. So.
Okay.
You know, a question I've been asking others as well, and something that seems to be an important issue in women in the field is mentorship. And who were your mentors, and when you were first getting started, and or were there any?
Well, there were examples. There in the Bay Area, there were many women already in the sort of bluegrass scene or on the periphery of it. And so I did not think that it was in any way peculiar or out of place to play bluegrass music. I mean, I loved it and I played it. Right. And I would say for mentors, my mentors were mostly men. I'm in the Bay Area. Mm-hmm. For fiddle, certainly, you know, Paul Schalasky was a great mentor to me at the beginning, and Pat Enright, singer and guitar player, was just, you know, he was great. Yeah. And I don't know, I just in the Bay Area, let's see, there was also Maine Smith, who was a great mentor to me.
Okay. And Maine played which instrument?
Well, Maine played dobro. He also played pedal steel in a sort of a country, folk country band.
Okay.
I think they were kind of cutting edge the way that they blended bluegrass and folk and country and kind of more modern rock elements into their music.
Right.
And
it's always been more of an amalgam on the West Coast, maybe than this, what we would consider pure bluegrass or something, right?
Well, there are definitely pure bluegrass bands. Bands.
Whatever that is.
Yeah, and here in the Bay Area, you know, our biggest influence in terms of bluegrass is Bill Monroe. It's kind of a funny thing. In the Bay Area, it's been Bill Monroe. In the Southern California, it's been Flat and Scruggs. And maybe that's because of the Beverly Hillbillies. I don't know.
Wow.
But it's just the way it's worked out. So we're all acolytes of Bill Monroe up here.
Wow. I read that you started on some other instruments before landing upon the fiddle. I mean, I know you play lots of instruments. Did I read that wrong?
Well, I played classical violin when I was a kid. I started when I was 12, which is pretty old. I mean, these days kids start when they're 3 or something.
Right,
but I started when I was 12. And then about a year later, I started playing guitar. And then I got bitten by bluegrass banjo and tried to play bluegrass banjo. But I kind of quit music altogether when I graduated from high school. I graduated early and just kind of quit everything.
Okay.
And I didn't start up again until I kind of discovered the bluegrass scene at Paul's Saloon in San Francisco when I was maybe 22, 23, and I started playing fiddle.
Okay. When you were around 22, when you started playing fiddle, and you were playing more regularly just with friends in the area, and I mean, when was it that you started playing with bands, and what was the shift from being a person who plays music for fun to being, you know, a professional musician?
Well, the shift really just happened. I got my first call to play in a band when a fiddle player in a band called the Boomtown Lulus broke his collarbone. And they called me and asked me, they had a gig, you know, and asked me if I would sit in and play fiddle. And I did, and I'm sure I was terrible, but they liked me, and I liked them. And even when the fiddle player healed and came back, I stayed with the band for a while. Okay. And it was a really fun amateur band. They got some gigs, but they were mostly, they had other jobs, day jobs.
Right.
And then
as you did as well, right?
Oh yeah. As I did.
Yeah. That's an interesting story to me, how people go from going, okay, time to quit the day job, you know?
I didn't quit my day job until I was 36.
Right. Okay.
And that was because I inherited a little bit of money. And I decided I was running a violin shop at that time. Right. And it was like a full time job and a half.
So much work.
Yeah, so much work. And I decided, okay, I'm just going to go in the recording studio. I have these songs. I'm going to record them the way I hear them in my head, and just have this record of my songs.
Right.
And then I can go back to the violin shop. And what happened was I just came alive in the studio. I just realized that this is what I wanted to do. I did not want to do this violin shop thing.
Right.
I was on the wrong path for my heart. And so I decided I'm going to take the leap. Sold the shop, started playing music full time, and just never looked back.
Never looked back. So I think built into this conversation and this whole symposium is the assumption that being a woman somehow made your path different than it might have been had you been a man. Do you think of that at all, or do you have a
very different in many ways. I mean, this was like in the 1970s, you know, when I went, not when I made the commitment to actually only play music, but when I started playing in bands around the Bay Area, one of the bands that I started with my women friends was the Good Old Persons. And it started out being all women. We were just going to get together a good set of music to play at Paul's Saloon on jam night. And that was it. That was our goal. We did that. We played our set on jam night. we immediately got hired by the owner, by Paul Lampert. Mm-hmm. And then we had to learn a whole night's worth of material. And then we played, we were asked to play over at the Freight and Salvage in Berkeley, which was at the time was a tiny club, 75 people or something like that.
Right.
But because we were all women, it got written up in the Oakland Tribune. Mm-hmm. And on our first night playing for a listening audience like that, we had an audience that stretched out around the corner.
Wow.
To get in. And so, number one, one of the things that was different is an all men band would not have had that impact, media impact immediately,
right,
which we did because it was a novelty. But on the other hand, there was the, when I became like full-time professional musician and had a booking agent and things like that, things would happen like, she would pitch me for a festival and they would say, well, we already have our girl band. We already have our girl fiddler, which often was Alison Krauss, and she's, that's great.
Right.
But the assumption that one girl fiddler is like another girl fiddler and you can only have one of them at a festival is, it's ridiculous.
It is ridiculous. And I am sorry to say how often I've heard that story,
Oh yeah. It's rampant. And actually it happened to me for a festival booking about 5 years ago, which is pretty recent.
Right.
My band wanted to play on a particular day at the festival and I was told, no, we can't have you on that day because we have Claire Lynch on that day. As if, we can't have Tony Rice because we're already having Larry Sparks,
Right. It's crazy. Yeah. Oh my gosh.
Not that I'm comparing Claire and me to Tony and Larry, but.
No, I get the analogy, but so, I've had some similar experiences. How did you react? Did you?
I did say, you could really, what you're doing. You're this is an incredible stereotype you're doing, and you could really make a step forward and be at the forefront of booking if you just changed your mind about this. And he just laughed. And it's fine. We're friends. I didn't expect.
Yeah. From when you first started playing and you were not a professional and you would go to festivals and see who was on stage to now being part of that circuit and being on stage, have you seen a significant change in the number of women actually just on the stage?
Oh yeah, there's many more women on stage, many, many more. And the musicianship is awesome.
Right.
I mean, it's really great.
But, who of the young ones are inspiring you right now?
Definitely Tatiana Hargraves, Allison DeGroot, Bronwyn Keith Hines, fantastic fiddler.
Okay.
Ellie Hawkinson, wonderful musician. Emily Mann and Wilhelmina Frank Zerda of Paper Wings. They're a wonderful duo.
Wonderful. Yeah, I love them too. That's great. It's fun. It's fun to watch the younger women there seem to be more virtuoso instrumentalists mm-hmm. among women now than there were when I started.
Oh, for sure. I mean, you have people like Sierra Hull and Kristen Scott Benson.
Exactly. I
mean, there's just so many.
It makes me really happy every time I see it. It's always really refreshing and encouraging to me. So, yeah.
When I met Alison Krauss for the first time, it was at a festival in Canada. I was. I think I was 42. I think she was half my age and she was 16. So whatever that makes me.
Right.
But
I'm not doing math.
It was just tearing it up.
Yeah.
Vocally and fiddling. And yeah, there's been younger women coming up for a long time, and they are awesome.
That's awesome. Yeah.
Have to add in.
Oh, dude,
Molly Tuttle.
There you go.
She's one of our California babies, and I just have to add her in there. It's wonderful.
So I'm familiar with you from watching you at festivals, and you know, just knowing your music over the years, but also through a mutual friendship that we have with Alice Gerard. I know. Let's all just pause.
Yeah.
I know. I miss seeing her so much. I've over the years been able to see her fairly regularly, and of course nobody's seen anybody regularly right now. So I'm missing some Alice energy. I'm gonna manipulate things so I can make that happen. And I think of her as a mentor. Yeah, and I know you did a record of was it the Hazel and Al, what is it called? The Hazel and Alice Sessions.
Yeah.
Yeah. Tell me a little bit about that project.
Okay. Well, I was loving playing in my band, The Right Hands, and we really wanted to do some kind of a recording. And I thought, rather than just do a band recording, you know, here's this song and here's that song, it would be nice to have something cohesive to go together, like, a theme for the album. And honestly, I was talking about it with Tom Rosum, and I was saying, I don't know what we should do. And Tom said, Hazel and Alice.
Before I go, dear brothers and sisters, won't you come and sing for me? Benches all on. How dear to my heart, how precious the moments we stood shaking hands and singing a song.
And as soon as he said it, I just went, that is so obvious. And yes, of course, that's what we should do. And I mentioned it to the rest of the band. Everybody jumped on it.
Right.
And that was it.
I love it. And you brought in some other friends to sing on that as well, correct?
I did. Linda Ronstadt sang on it.
Okay.
Aoife O'Donovan sang on it. I was very lucky.
Oh, well, I think everybody was very lucky. That was a beautiful project. I know you've worked with Kathy Kallick a lot over the years too.
Oh, yeah. We started playing together and singing together. I mean, when we were, I like to think she's the closest person I have to being a sibling to sing with, because we've been singing together for, 50 years.
I love it.
Basically. And she and I were founding members of the Good Old Persons and played and sang together in that band starting in 1974, I think. And I left the band in early 77 or something. And we have continued to team up together ever since then for projects, our Vernon Ray duet album and our nice. Just our together album, which was just us yeah. singing songs together. And
that's, yeah, of course. The sisters have to do those things. you did another project with all women too, Blue Rose, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that was the brainchild of Kathy Fink and Marcy Marxer, and right. they just called me and asked me if I wanted to do it.
Right.
And it sounded great. I said yes, and let's get Sally Van Meter.
You know, I know over the years, besides just playing instruments and writing songs and singing and leading bands, you've also been producing and you know, taking on other kinds of projects. Can you talk to me a little bit about your producing?
Well, my philosophy of producing is to try and understand what the artist really wants to portray, and then help that person get the very best version of that out there that I can help them with. And that's it in a nutshell. I'm not taking somebody and shaping them to my will or my idea
right.
of what they should be. For instance, when I produced Alice Gerard's album, I had ideas for the songs, but I really wanted to make sure that I wasn't pushing Alice in some direction she didn't want to go.
Mm-hmm.
So we had a lot of back and forth about, you know, I'd say, what do you think about this setting for this song? And how about this tempo? And, you know, things like that. And she generally was 100% in agreement with me, even though I was kind of like shy at first about making suggestions because it's Alice Gerard and, you know,
right.
But I had very strong ideas, and generally they were what Alice was thinking.
Right. Well, I mean, that just is an example of you two being a good match for that situation. Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah. Have you produced any younger artists or been in more, I mean, an example maybe of someone who's not Alice Gerard, you know, someone who's younger and less sure of their sound or less sure of their intentions?
Definitely. In fact, right now I'm just finishing up a wonderful project with a musician from Placerville here in California, Daisy Kerr, and she's a fantastic guitarist, songwriter, singer, fiddle player, mandolin player.
Wow.
And, 15.
Wow.
And yeah, it's going to be a really great album.
But she probably needs a little more guidance, maybe.
Well, a lot of shaping on the songs and the treatment and stuff like that. Yes.
Yeah.
Quite a bit more, but.
Doesn't have experience. Yeah.
She's placed it into my hands. I'm listening to her and trying to trying to help her find her voice. And I think we're doing a good job.
Yeah. For folks who are watching this in some year that's not 2020 down the line, we're in the middle of a global pandemic and there are virtually no live concerts in the United States right now. And folks like Laurie did not do a festival circuit this summer, and there aren't big concerts, and we're at home. And one question I would ask you would be, you know, what are you working on now? What's next? And I'm sure you have some answers for those, but it's different than, I'm on tour.
Right. Yes. Well, right at the beginning of the pandemic in March, I actually had studio time booked for my band to do another album. Nice. And of course that got canceled, and we haven't been able to figure out a way to make that happen yet. Cause we're not all in the same town.
Right.
And
so it requires travel or air travel and
exactly.
staying places and being in close proximity. Yeah, it's a real problem.
So I've shelved that, but for a while when the pandemic first hit and all, I mean, I had a new album coming out. I had an incredibly packed March, April, May, June. I mean, just tons of gigs for this album.
Mm-hmm.
And that all fell by the wayside. So I started doing little song a day videos here at home, where I just sit and play guitar and sing one of my songs. All songs I've written, I just decided to challenge myself to be a soloist, because I never am.
Here we go.
Somebody else.
Okay.
And for a while, I think I did about 30 songs that way, but then I just suddenly got bored with myself and I quit.
I had a similar experience. Early in the pandemic, I did, you know, the live things fairly often, and then I was just like, I'm really tired of listening to myself right now. So, wow. Do you have advice for young women who are entering the field as professionals?
Well, I don't know about just young women, but young people in particular. I have to say, there are so many amazing young musicians these days who have sort of gotten funneled into this idea that they're going to be able to make a living playing live music.
Right.
And my heart goes out to them, because I don't know how they're going to do it. I don't know where they're going to play. And hopefully y'all are young enough and agile enough and flexible enough to change course, mm-hmm. and figure out what's next, what's going to really work. But whatever it is, I just hope that people try to do what's in their heart and don't do something because you think it'll be more popular or is the hip thing to do. I mean, I just follow right. your heart.
Mm-hmm.
And if you can make a living doing that, then that's really, really terrific. It's to be applauded. If you need to bring in some money from somewhere else, do that, but follow your heart. We right. need authentic, we need to hear from your soul.
Mm-hmm. Amen. I needed to hear that today. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Great. Well, thank you so much for being with us today and for sharing your time and your stories. And
it's my pleasure. Thank you for including me.
Of course. It would have been incomplete without you.
In need of something to make me new. A voice to sing in harmony. Or lead a brand new tune. Sing away these troubled times and make it through. Sing away these troubled times and make it through. Despair is my worst enemy, and I am fear's own daughter. The path of least resistance draws my will to it like water. So neighbor, lend a cup of strength, and I'll pay back twice to you. And we'll face these troubled times and see them through. We'll face these troubled times and see them through.